I will request Dr. Shivakumar to present on the large vessel stenting indications and techniques. As we already know, Dr. Shivakumar is an excellent pediatric interventional cardiologist. We are going to have the interesting cases going to be presented now.
Thank you, chairpersons.
About large vessel stenting, what we call as large vessel is either the aorta or the pulmonary artery. Sometimes when we put conduits from the right ventricle to pulmonary artery, they are also referred to as large vessel stents and superior and the inferior vena cava. I'll probably go around the periphery and then finally come into the coarctation where probably I'll be stressing more. IVC stenting is primarily restricted to the distal end of the inferior vena cava where the IVC joins the right atrium as in Budd-Chiari syndrome, and it can be stented. The only thing that we need to ensure is that we need to put in quite a large stent so that there is no flow turbulence at all. About SVC obstruction, it is very common to see superior vena cava obstructions in patients who had been on chronic dialysis, and when they get into SVC syndrome, then you probably may have to resort to SVC stenting. Coming to pulmonary artery stenting, if there is a unilateral pulmonary artery stenosis, there will not be any elevation of the right ventricular systolic pressure because there will be a compensatory excessive flow into the other lungs, and so we will not be expecting any higher right ventricular systolic pressure. So on an echocardiogram, if we are going to be getting a gradient across one of the pulmonary artery, even if it is something like 20 or 25 millimeters of mercury, we need to do a perfusion scan and identify how much of hyperperfusion it has caused. And if the perfusion is going to be anything less than 30% in a very small baby, we need to stent it because the lung growth is proportionate to the amount of blood supply. In bilateral pulmonary artery stenosis, stenting will be indicated if the right ventricular systolic pressure is increasing, more so if there is RV dilatation dysfunction or marked right ventricular hypertrophy. These are some of the examples of pulmonary artery stenosis. A distal MPA stenosis with a very good sized RP and LPA, you see that it's being stented. Sometimes the distal end of the MPA stenting may extend on to the proximal portion of the RPA and LPA, where you may have to do something like a Y stenting. This is a Y stent that goes from the main pulmonary artery into both the branch PAs. Some tetralogies may have extremely severe hyperplasia of the pulmonary arteries, and then you feel that if we do a total corrective repair and promote an antegrade flow, there may be an improvement of the PAs. However, some of them, you will have a wide open main pulmonary artery. However, the branch pulmonary arteries may remain ridiculously small even after the repair, and in which case you may have to go and stent them to very large levels. Unilateral pulmonary artery stenosis, as I mentioned earlier, we should not wait till the right ventricular systolic pressure gets elevated because it will never happen. So, and these stenosis often will be at the ductal site and will be managed with discrete stenting of those vessels. Another peculiar situation of unilateral pulmonary artery stenosis, especially in univentricular hearts, will be the post-Glenn PA stenosis, where the pulmonary artery is compressed by the aorta looping around the pulmonary artery. And in these cases, once again, a stenting will be useful to relieve the pulmonary artery stenosis. Now, the message in pulmonary artery stenosis, a simple balloon dilatation is always unsatisfactory because there is a terrible recoil. And sometimes in non-compliant lesions, we can use cutting balloons. However, stenting is the best method to relieve the narrowing. In bilateral stenosis, high right ventricular systolic pressure can be taken as an indication. However, in unilateral stenosis, we need to go by differential perfusion as measured by technetium-labeled macro-aggregated albumin lung perfusion scan. In post-bidirectional Glenn or post-Fontan surgery, even very small gradients, as low as up to 1 to 2 millimeters of mercury, may be very, very significant, and we may have to resort to stenting. Now, coming to conduit stenting, conduits are used in right ventricle to pulmonary artery. Sometimes this is a Hancock conduit, which is a commercially available conduit. Another commercially available conduit is Contegra, which is a bovine jugular vein. And in many centers, there may be homografts. And these conduits, when they get narrowed, if we do a stenting, we may be able to postpone the next conduit change, and thereby we'll be able to get a few more years. Aortic stenting, I will again touch upon the periphery and then come into the center. Takayasu's iatrogenesis is one of the condition where, you know, the a problem like a long segment aortic narrowing will be better dealt with if you use a covered CP stent or a Advanta atrium covered stent. It's better to avoid a bare stent in aorta arteritis. The reason being, sometimes if it ruptures and the surgeon has to go and repair the vessel, surgeon will find it very difficult because the thickened, hard, cartilaginous vessel will be difficult to clamp by the surgeon by when he goes in through a left thoracotomy, and we'll be finding the surgery very messy. And so it's rather better to go for a covered stent. Coarctation of aorta, where probably I'll be spending most of the time, will be hemodynamically defined as a systolic gradient of more than 20 millimeters of mercury. However, we know that low gradient coarctations can be due to ventricular dysfunction or associated large PDA or massive collaterals or an entity called pseudocoarctation, where there is really no gradient but extreme tortuosity. Why should we stent a coarctation? Why not we simply balloon dilate it? Whenever we balloon dilate, there is going to be some intimal tears, and the stenting is going to tack all the dissections, and it's going to avoid a recoil. It also prevents aneurysm. Most important, it totally eliminates the gradient. You'll be able to come off the lab with near zero gradients. If that is the case, why not stent all the coarctation? Aorta continues to grow in any child up to 14 to 18 years. And so if you are going to stent a child at 6 years or 10 years with coarctation, then you should be prepared to go in and redilate the stent. So, which means all the coarctation stents has to be redilatable stents. We should not be using the non-redilatable stents. In discrete coarctation with a good-sized isthmus, sometimes we may get excellent results with ballooning alone. However, in patients, wherever there is an isthmic hypoplasia, we have to resort to stenting. This is a typical scenario, a discrete coarctation in a 20-year-old person. You can appreciate the stenosis here. And after taking the measurements of the pre-coarctation isthmus, then you put in a sheath inside. And this is a bib balloon. Bib balloon is a balloon in balloon. If, for example, if you are choosing a 16 millimeter balloon, there will be an inner balloon which is 8 millimeter. So initially you dilate only the inner balloon, and then after getting the inner balloon dilated, look at the position whether it is satisfactory, and then subsequently go for the outer balloon dilatation. And this represents one of the very simple coarctation stenting procedure. Why not we use this balloon in balloon in every patient? It is at the cost of a large sheath size. So if you can achieve a coarctation stenting with a balloon in balloon, very often you have to go for a 12 French sheath. And so today it is not one of the preferred balloons for coarctation stenting. So what do we do now? We use marker pictel more often in the recent years to be very exact. And then we position the stent midway. And after positioning the stent, to avoid stent migration, we rapid pace the right ventricle and we expand the stent with not a bib balloon, with one of the usually available with cord is a Maxi LD or a Boston Scientific XXL balloon. This is the cord is 4014 stent, which can be post dilated even up to 25 millimeter if there is a situational need. We'll go on to more and more complexity. This is an extremely tortuous coarctation. Whenever there is so much of tortuosity, it is safer always to use a covered stent because there can be rupture along the outer wall, and this is a covered CP stent which is getting inflated, again not by a bib balloon, with an ordinary balloon. And one another useful tip will be to take a radial access, put in a pigtail catheter on the arch and keep checking with small hand injections whether our position is correct at every stage. And this will result in complete elimination of the gradients. Sometimes there can be extremely tight coarctations wherein you may have to pass the wire from the top because you may not be able to cross from below and snare it from below. And then, once again, this is a radial access pigtail catheter to localize the coarctation. And here we use an Advanta V12, which is, again, another PTFE covered stent. Sometimes the tight lesions can be near interruptions. This is a totally sort of an interrupted aorta. When we are injecting, hardly any dye goes below. And in these cases, sometimes we may have to use a very cautious, low pressure balloon dilatation to create a space for the sheath to go up. Otherwise, the sheath may not be having space to enter across the lesion. You can see that the pigtail is being hugged by the catheter. And in these cases, you have to use a small balloon to create some lumen and then use the sheath. And once again, we are using a covered CP stent, which is useful to prevent any sort of rupture in that area. The message in native coarctation, if there is an isthmic hypoplasia, stenting is the most reliable way of relieving the gradient. In older patients where somatic growth is nearly complete, stenting is even preferred in discrete coarctations also. We use marker pictel, we use rapid RV pacing, and we use covered stent if the dilatation is more than 3.5 times. Is there a role in younger children if the lesion is very resistant to balloon dilatation or if there is isthmic hypoplasia? Whenever we have to dilate a transverse arch or if the lesion is extremely tight. This is a 3-year-old child who failed to get a good result with a balloon dilatation, and in that case we have to resort to stenting, and you can see that it's a stent of 2910 which can be dilated up to 18 millimeter when the child grows bigger. This is a transverse arch stenting. You can notice the pre-subclavian transverse arch coarctation, and there is a subclavian artery narrowing also. Once again, here there is no role for covered stent. We may have to go for bare stenting. A bare CP stent is deployed in this location and resulting in a completely wide open flow with no gradients at all. This is a recoarctation in a child with an isthmic hypoplasia and a distal transverse arch hypoplasia. Now, the major problems that might happen in coarctation are, one is balloon rupture, second is stent malposition, and third is aortic rupture. Balloon rupture happens whenever we are choosing either a very compliant low pressure balloon, or sometimes if the lesion is very, very rigid. You can see a metal clip on this coarctation. It is a post TGA arterial switch where the surgeon has left a clip on the anterior wall of the aorta where he divided the ductus. And when we are inflating a CP stent on a balloon, the balloon ruptures because this lesion, the metal clip offers a lot of resistance for the dilatation. Then you have to advance a much more higher pressure balloon through the same stent and then get it deployed on the same position. Once the balloon ruptures, we need to carefully take out the balloon and reintroduce another new low profile balloon. And this is the same stent in final position. Stent migration is another problem, especially when it is on the transverse aortic arch. You can see that the stent is perfectly positioned with the balloon is nicely positioned. And as the balloon is getting inflated, you can see the top end of the balloon here. And as the balloon goes up, you can see that the stent is actually getting milked into the arch. And the balloon, in fact, moves down. This is melon seeding of the balloon. And if that is the case, what we need to do will be pass a very small balloon across and then slowly inflate it. And as the inflation happens, drag it down back into the place and then get it into the position. This is an example of a post-Norwood stage 2 for hypoplastic left heart syndrome. This is the Glenn circuit, and this is the neo-aorta where there is a discrete coarctation which is stented once again in a very small child of around 4 years with a 4014 stent on a 12 mm balloon, which once again this stent can be post dilated later. Aortic rupture is another dreaded complication. You know, I'm so far fortunate enough not to show you an example, but I fear I may have to show you one in another few years. Pray well and have a covered stent always in shelf, either a covered CP or an Advanta Atrium V12. How do you ensure more safety? Smallest profile balloon and stents, because sometimes there can be large retroperitoneal hematomas when you use huge sheets, and no routine pre-dilatation at all. But pre-dilate if you are expecting in a few patients with a low pressure balloon to assess the compliance. If you feel that the compliance of the lesion is not very good, then sometimes you can pre-dilate like a Tyshak 2 balloon. Rapid RV pacing and marker pigtails are useful things, and always have covered stent on shelf. The newer techniques are rotational angiography. You can see this is a rotational angiogram. The moment you do the angiogram, then the machine gives a good reconstruction. And once again, this is a post-stent rotational angiogram. This is an intra-stent mega. You can see that this is the stent position with its location. Everything is nicely seen. The advantage of using this rotational angiogram will be to precisely identify in which projection the coarctation is getting nicely delineated so that you can deploy in that particular position. The bottlenecks, as I told you earlier, are aortic rupture, stent malposition, displacement or migration, balloon rupture. There are certain difficulties in transverse arch stenting and also stenting in under 6 years. The tips will be, in most of the recoactations, if the balloon is not yielding good results, try to use a stent and use large post-dilatable stents, either the CORDI stents, CP stents, or the Advanta atrium. In univentricular hearts, even when the absolute, even when the gradients are quite low, you need to stent them, and we want zero residual gradient. Pre-stent balloon dilatation is rarely done to create a lumen or to check the compliance. High pressure balloon is needed for in post-op non-compliant coarctation. For example, if there is a post-surgical coarctation, then you should have some Atlas balloons, Conquest balloons and all in shelf to get the stent opened up. Rapid RV pacing, bib balloons may prevent stent migration. PTFE covered stents used in situations where rupture may occur. Low profile covered stents of the atrium. In younger children, do not hesitate to use a stent if there is a need. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shivakumar. It's a really excellent presentation, and you have put all your experience in this presentation. I think Shivakumar has got a very good experience in large vessel stenting, especially complex coarctations and all. So if there are any questions, we can take a couple of questions. Jaydeva Center is readily waiting. Ma'am has got questions.
Most excellent lecture I have heard in the recent past, but only in the lighter vein. One slide I did not understand. Why did you get Sri Rama there?
You have to pray that you don't rupture.
Shiva, you have shown that bilateral native branch pulmonary stenosis, maybe Williams or Rubella, I don't know. What is your recommendation of stents? What size we can actually safely can go? That's what generally we don't understand. It's a thread-like vessels you have shown. I am really scared to expand to 12 millimeters, 14 millimeters in those situation straight away. So
okay. Now in coarctation there are well laid set guidelines. If you are going to stent a coarctation more than 3.5 times the narrowest lumen, you have to use a covered stent. Pulmonary arteries do not have any such guidelines. Now what I we always use a bare stent in pulmonary artery, and I feel that it is very safe to dilate a pulmonary artery up to 5 to 6 times its diameter using bare stents. There are vessels which are about 1.5 to 2 millimeters, which I had blown up to 12 millimeters in the first situation, like straight away using it. I think pulmonary arteries being very very elastic arteries, they permit you.
That's why plain balloon usually recoiling is.
Yeah, plain balloon always recoils, and
probably
we don't.
It's a elastic nature.
Correct. And I won't be scared to dilate up to 5 to 6 times the narrowest portion of the pulmonary artery. In fact, I didn't stress on pulmonary artery stenting because I thought a fair proportion of this audience may be venturing into coarctation rather than into pulmonary artery stenting, and so I thought we'll just rush through the pulmonary artery and spend more time on the coarctations.
Sir, for completion's sake, just I wanted to know about the pulmonary vein stenting. Do you consider as a large vessel? Because I have seen that electrophysiologists are using a 10 and 12 millimeters stents for the pulmonary veins.
I understand. Actually, I'm not experienced in stenting the pulmonary vein in the post RF ablation adults who are getting into pulmonary vein stenosis. Some of the children, some of the neonates who presented with severe pulmonary vein native stenosis presenting as PPHN and who were quite moribund, stuck on the ventilator, I had resorted in the past to stenting, and we will be very happy to come out of the cath lab and will be able to extubate the patient, but 3 months down the road, the patient will have severe intimal restenosis and there is no solutions available. Similarly, second another solution is the post TAPVC pulmonary vein hypoplasia, where you perforate the interatrial septum, get into the left atrium, and then you try to dilate that pulmonary veins. Once again, in the past, about 4 or 5 years before, I was very happy to stent those lesions. Today, I will never touch a stent. This is one of the lesion where coronary cutting balloon can be used, followed by just simple balloon dilatation and coming out. I think your question is specific to post RF ablation, atrial fibrillation, pulmonary vein stenosis. Their stents are going to be very useful because you have already reached the adult size of those pulmonary veins. And I suppose the 10 to 12 millimeters should be good enough. And these patients probably will be on long-term anticoagulation.
probably intraoperative pulmonary venous stenting, the case reports, because always a native pulmonary venous disease, it's a progressive disease, veno-occlusive disease equivalent. So even we shared, I shared my experience with Shukumar earlier, we have stented couple of babies, but it's a progressive disease. If you stent one, another pulmonary vein also will be obstructed.
And yeah, even the stented vessel will stenose after 6 months, and we are nowhere. We cannot redilate those stents.
Yeah, native disease is a very progressive, and it is a diffuse also. Yeah.
Diffuse, and these are babies who are 2.5 to 3 kilograms, very, very tiny. And